Math Blast 32, Tuesday, determining the unknown. Fill in the missing factor. 7 times blank equals 49. That's 7 groups of something. 7 times 7 is 49. So 49 divided by 7 would be 7. That means I have 49 total items and I'm dividing them or equally sharing them into 7 groups or groups of 7. 36 is equal to 9 times blank. 9 groups of 4 is equal to 36. So 9 is equal to 36 divided by 4. Those are related facts. 2-step word problems. Sadie had 7 makeup brushes. Elena had 6 makeup brushes. When Elena went away to college, she took 9 of their brushes with her. How many makeup brushes did Sadie have left? Okay, so first off, I know if Sadie had 7 makeup brushes and Elena had 9 makeup brushes, then I can put those together. We're going to add them to determine the total number of makeup brushes that both Sadie and Elena had. So 7 plus 9 is equal to 16. Now, when Elena went away, she took 9 of the brushes. So here, we start out with the 16 brushes. And if she took 9, then we ask ourselves, how many are left here? This would be a subtraction problem. 16 minus 9 is equal to 7. So we can say Sadie has 7 brushes left. Rounding, round 578 to the nearest 10. I'm going to use a vertical number line here. At the bottom of my vertical number line, since I'm rounding to the nearest 10, I'm going to ask myself, if 10s are the largest unit, how many 10s make up my number? So I need to go all the way to the 10s place. 57 10s currently make up my number. In standard form, that's 570. If I add one more 10, I would have 58 10s, which in standard form is 580. The midpoint, the number right between 570 and 580, is 575. Now I want to locate my number on the number line. 578 is going to be about here. And so now I can say, since my number is above the midpoint, it's going to round up to 580. Any number that lies at or above the midpoint will round up, and those numbers that are below the midpoint would round down. Round 578 to the nearest 100. This time, for my vertical number line, I'm going to decide how many hundreds. Hundreds will be my largest unit at this point. How many hundreds make up my number? So I'll go all the way to the hundreds place. 5 hundredths. In standard form, that's 500. If I am to add one more 100, I would have 6 hundredths. In standard form, that's 600. The number right between 500 and 600, the midpoint, is 550. Now, locating my number, 578, on the number line, I'm going to say that's about here. I'll note 578 is here, and since that is at or above the midpoint, it will round up to 600. Number line partitioning. Partition each hole into 6 equal pieces and label each partition. Now be careful here because our number line is going from 0 to 2. So that's not one hole, that's actually 2 holes. We want to partition each hole into 6 equal pieces. So between 0 and 1, I want 6 equal parts. Between 1 and 2, I want 6 equal parts. Now we need to label each partition. So this would be 0/6, and then we would continue 1/6, 2/6, 3/6, 4/6, 5/6, and one whole would be 6/6. We can continue on. We have 7/6, 8/6, 9/6, 10/6, 11/6, and 2 holes would be 12/6, because 1 hole is 6/6, so another hole, 6/6 plus 6/6, would be 12/6. Comparing fractions. Compare the fractions using greater than, less than, or equal. Justify using the fraction models. So our first set of fractions, 2/6 versus 2/3, shares a common numerator. That's the number of pieces that we have, or that will be shaded in this case. So I'm going to break my first model into 6 equal parts. The units are represented in the denominator. 6 equal parts. And I'm going to shade 2 of those. In the next fraction model, I will break my whole into 3 equal parts as represented in the denominator there. My units will be thirds. And I will shade in 2 of those. And now I can see that 2/6 is less than 2/3. When I have a model that's broken into more pieces, it's going to have smaller pieces than that same size model broken into less pieces. Our next fraction set here is 1/4 versus 4/4. Here, our fractions share a common denominator, so the number of equal parts in the whole, the units that we're dealing with, are the same. I'm going to break each model into 4/4, 4 equal parts. In the first model, I'm going to shade 1 of those parts. In the second model, I'm going to shade 4 of those parts. Now we can see that 1/4 is less than 4/4. On the back side, elapsed time. Write the start time shown on each clock. When we're finding time, we want to look at the shorthand and the longhand. The shorthand deals with the hour. The longhand helps us determine the minutes. So, taking a look at the shorthand, I can see that it is on the 4, not to the 5 yet. So we're in the 4 o'clock hour. And then looking at the longhand, starting at the top of the clock would be o'clock. And every time it moves a number around the clock, it has passed 5 minutes. So we will go from the top of the clock and go 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, 30 at the bottom of the clock, 35, 40, 45, 50, 55. It is 4:55 a.m. For the end time, looking at the shorthand, we're at the 6 o'clock hour. And looking at the longhand, starting at the top of the clock would be o'clock. As I move around, I have 5, 10, 15, 20. On the 4, it would be 20 minutes past 6 o'clock. How much time has passed from start to end? I'm going to use the arrow method here. If we start at 4:55, I want to go to the next hour. That would be 5 o'clock. That was 5 minutes. We added 5 minutes. Next, I'm going to go to the next hour, 6 o'clock. That was 1 hour. And now I want to take it to 6:20. That was 20 additional minutes. Now, when I put together the movements I've had to make, it would be 1 hour and 25 minutes. So how much time has passed? We're going to say here, 1 hour, 25 minutes. Area, tiling. Find the area of the rectangle by tiling it. So here, I'm going to finish the rectangle. I'm going to tile it by completing the columns and the rows, and now I can count all of the squares within my rectangle to determine the area. The area are the square units that cover the two-dimensional surface. So, other than counting those, I could also say, well, I know I have 4 columns and I have 3 rows, and 3 times 4 is equal to 12. So the area is 3 units times 4 units, which is equal to 12 square units. That little 2 means squared. units, or we could represent that as 12 and just write the little symbol square units. Shape attributes. Check all that apply for the given shape. Here, in the first column, all of the names are dealing with triangles. Tri means three. This is not a three-sided polygon, so no triangle names will match our shape. In the second column, we have quadrilaterals and special types of quadrilaterals. Quadrilaterals are four-sided figures, so again, none of those names will match our shape. In the third column, we have polygons that have specific numbers of sides: pentamines 5, hexamines 6, heptamines 7, and octamines 8. And we can see that our polygon here has 8 sides, so it's going to be the octagon. And I might say here, octa is what helped me